how toxic stress impacts California's children, families, and communities, a webinar presented by Children Now, Center for Youth Wellness, and Californians for Safety and Justice.
And with that, I'll turn it over to Children Now's Senior Health Policy Associate, Dr. Ben Rubin, to get us started. Dr. Rubin has a background in neuroscience research and health policy advocacy and has been leading Children Now's work on toxic stress.
Great. Thanks for the introduction, Rosanna. I'm very happy to have this opportunity to share Children Now's perspective on toxic stress and to invite a couple of our partners to do the same. We're joined today by two of our partners, the Center for Youth Wellness and Californians for Safety and Justice, who along with Children Now co-sponsored Assembly Concurrent Resolution 155. ACR 155 is a legislative resolution that passed earlier this year, urging the commitment of the California State Legislature to identify evidence-based solutions to reduce children's exposure to toxic stress and adverse childhood experiences and to address their impacts. So here's our agenda for the next hour. I'll lead off by defining toxic stress and talking about how the brain and body deal with stress, how to talk about toxic stress, some related concepts like risk and protective factors, and some policy frameworks that are based on these factors. I'll follow that by quickly relating these concepts to the various systems that serve children and families, and then we'll introduce our first speaker, Dr. Karen Hill, who will be presenting on toxic stress in healthcare. Dr. Hill will be followed by Milena Blake, who will be presenting on toxic stress in public safety and justice. And then I'll wrap things up by highlighting some policy work relating to toxic stress in child-serving systems and suggesting some next steps. In whatever time's left before noon, Dr. Hill, Ms. Blake, and I will be available to answer questions that you all hopefully be submitting throughout the webinar. So before defining toxic stress, let's ask a quick poll question. How familiar are you with toxic stress? All right, the poll should be self-explanatory. Just indicate your familiarity with toxic stress by selecting one of the three choices that are hopefully directly in front of you now. I know some of the people who've joined for the webinar are familiar with the term toxic stress, but it'll be helpful to get a rough idea of how many people here are familiar with it and to what degree. Okay, let's close the poll. Thanks everyone for responding. It'll just take me a moment to see the results. All right, we have 20% of participants don't know much about toxic stress, 56% have some information, and 24% know a lot about it. So that looks like a really rough bell curve, which is great. We have a mix of folks with not much knowledge, some with some, and then great to have some experts joining us as well. So for those of you who aren't intimately familiar with the term, toxic stress is a concept that was coined and popularized by the Center on the Developing Child at Harvard University. And the information you'll see on the next three slides is largely taken from their work. I'll be mentioning sources throughout the presentation, but we'll also provide a list of resources at the end, and we'll also be sending out the slides to everyone after the webinar. So let's start with stress. Stress is a word used to describe experiences that are challenging emotionally and physiologically. All children face stress, that's inevitable, but learning to deal with stress is an important part of normal development, and not all stress is harmful. Stressful events can even be beneficial under some circumstances. So the key to understanding how the body deals with stress is that stress responses are adaptive. They're the body's way of handling an emergency situation and prioritizing survival. This figure shows some of the important components of the body's stress response system. The brain is the central organ of the response to stress because it determines what's threatening, and therefore potentially stressful, and triggers the subsequent physiological and behavioral responses to stress. Many parts of the brain are involved in the response to stress, from the hypothalamus, which triggers neuroendocrine responses to stressors, to the higher cognitive areas of the brain that play key roles in memory, anxiety, and decision-making. When exposed to stress, the brain and body go on alert, and the stress response system is activated to produce the classical fight or flight response. The heart rate increases, and stress hormones like adrenaline and cortisol are released from the adrenal glands, located on top of the kidneys, into the bloodstream. These hormones trigger a variety of effects, like inhibiting our digestive and immune systems. Again, all of these responses are adaptive. They're the body's way of prioritizing survival when a threat is perceived. These responses allow the body to summon energy reserves to face the immediate threat and ignore less immediate concerns like digestion, reproduction, long-term immune responses, and any non-urgent information. Once the source of anxiety passes, or in the case of a child, a caregiver is present to help the child cope with the stress in a productive way, the body quickly goes back to normal. Now, events that trigger positive stress responses, like being dropped off at preschool, are typically those that a child can learn to manage well with the support of safe, stable, and nurturing relationships. These are characterized by moderate and short-lived stress responses, such as brief increases in heart rate and mild elevations of stress hormones. In contrast to positive stress, tolerable stress refers to stress responses that have the potential to negatively impact the architecture of the developing brain, such as in response to the death of a loved one or a frightening accident. Potentially damaging stress responses can fortunately be tempered by the presence of supportive relationships with adults and safe environments, which help children learn to manage and recover from the stress. In these cases, the stress responses are deemed tolerable. Finally, toxic stress refers to stress responses that are strong, frequent, or prolonged, which ample research has shown can negatively impact brain development. This is when the body's stress responses are no longer adaptive, but stick around for a long time anyway. It's like when the body responds to an infection. The responses are adaptive. Fever, for example, helps to cook bacteria, but they can also cause a lot of damage if they persist for too long. Stressful events like physical or emotional abuse that are chronic, uncontrollable, or experienced without children having access to protective relationships and safe environments tend to provoke toxic stress responses. The part about access to protective relationships and environments is really critical here. The effects of toxic stress can be particularly damaging during the fetal and early childhood periods when the neural circuits and hormonal systems for dealing with stress are rapidly developing and are particularly malleable. In extreme cases of exposure to toxic stress, the stress response system can change so that it responds more strongly or frequently to things that might not even be stressful to others. As a result, children may feel threatened and respond impulsively when no real threat exists, or perhaps remain excessively anxious long after the threat has gone away. As you'll hear about in more detail from Dr. Hill, these kinds of experiences increase the risk of developing a wide variety of serious stress-related physical, mental, and behavioral problems, ranging from depression and addiction to diabetes and cardiovascular disease. The two most critical things to stress here are that positive, tolerable, and toxic stress refer to the stress response system's effects on the body, not to the experiences themselves. And that the really toxic part of toxic stress is stress in the absence of a supportive caregiver to help mitigate it. It's also important to note that positive, tolerable, and toxic stress are not clinically quantifiable, at least not now, but they're a useful way of categorizing the relative severity of responses to stressful conditions. The assertion that toxic stress is a useful concept is not just a flip comment. It's actually backed by a lot of research. The Center on the Developing Child has partnered with the Frameworks Institute to study how communications about early childhood development influences public attitudes and policy preferences. In one study, the influence of a variety of frames were tested against several outcome measures of interest, including public support for policies that address children's developmental needs. Among the frames tested, toxic stress exerted the largest influence. So this and other research, as well as the experiences of people trying to connect the science to policy, lead to some suggestions about how to talk about toxic stress. First off, start with the science. The frameworks research I mentioned earlier shows pretty clearly that fuzzy concepts like stress are not taken as seriously as the brain. People often assume that a child is an empty vessel up to a certain developmental point, but that's not how the brain works. What happens very early on is foundational to everything that follows, including physical environment, and especially the social environment and relationships with adults. So while what happens very early on is critical, the brain is plastic. Toxic does not imply deterministic, and extreme circumstances do not constitute death sentences for children and families. Experiences influence but don't determine outcomes. Now, one reason they aren't deterministic is because individual differences matter. How an individual responds to a particular event or circumstance depends on the complex interplay between an individual's experiences and their genetic makeup, including the expression of so-called resilience genes that can, for example, protect some people from becoming depressed under extreme stress. Now, just because one person demonstrates resilience in a particular circumstance doesn't mean that another person should be affected the same way. The way this interplay shapes the developing brain architecture, is key. When people think about development, they tend to think of it as the accumulation of knowledge or learning. However, we want to avoid the separation of mind and body and show that brain architecture is shaped by all kinds of stimuli, and that this architecture will affect both learning and health for the rest of a child's life. Of course, toxic stress affects children and caregivers. It can be enormously difficult to overcome the powerful effect stress can have on the body. Having supportive relationships are critical for ensuring that stress does not become toxic for both children and adults. And finally, toxic stress impacts all systems that involve children and caregivers. Sometimes it can be hard to communicate across the languages and terminologies that have developed in different agencies and service traditions. Some folks are talking about child maltreatment, some are talking about stress, and so on. A helpful approach to bridge communication gaps is to start with the science. Now, when you start with the science that addresses how children's stress responses can be toxic, the question that naturally follows is, what can be done about it? The good news is that there's a lot of evidence for factors that influence stress responses that could be used to inform policies designed to prevent or mitigate the effects of toxic stress. The bad news is that it's very difficult to study whether a particular stressor is positive, tolerable, or toxic for a particular individual at a particular time. We can, however, measure things that we know frequently cause toxic stress in children, like childhood trauma, child maltreatment, or adverse childhood experiences, otherwise known as ACEs. All of these have working definitions and data sources that have been used in epidemiological studies of populations, not individuals, to identify risk and protective factors. The Center for Disease Control has focused a lot of its efforts on combating child maltreatment, which includes all types of abuse and neglect of a child by a parent, caregiver, or another person in a custodial role, including physical, sexual, and emotional abuse and neglect. The Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, SAMHSA, has developed a good working definition of trauma. Individual trauma results from an event, series of events, or set of circumstances that's experienced by an individual as physically or emotionally harmful or threatening, and that has lasting adverse effects on the individual's functioning and physical, social, emotional, or spiritual well-being. The key here is that trauma is the sum of the event, the individual's experience of the event, and the long-term adverse effects on an individual. We'll get into ACEs in a lot more depth later on. So as I mentioned, child maltreatment, trauma, and ACEs have been studied to identify risk and protective factors. Risk factors are attributes, characteristics, or exposures of an individual that increase the likelihood of developing a disease or injury. In this context, a stress-related disease or injury. Protective factors are conditions or attributes in individuals, families, communities, or the larger society that increase the health and well-being of children and families. Protective factors, which are sometimes called assets, help build child and family strength and an environment that promotes optimal child and youth development. So what are some of these risk and protective factors that are associated with outcomes that frequently cause toxic stress? Let's start with risk factors. This list comes from the Center for Disease Control's analysis of risk and protective factors that are associated with child maltreatment. The CDC has identified risk factors for both victimization and perpetration, which, again, are not necessarily causes, but are associated with child maltreatment. An example of a risk factor for victimization is having special needs that may increase caregiver burden, such as disabilities, mental health issues, and chronic physical illnesses. Risk factors for perpetration of child maltreatment have been identified at multiple levels. At the individual level, such as parents' lack of understanding of children's needs, child development, and parenting skills. At the family level, such as family disorganization, dissolution, and violence. And at the community level, such as concentrated neighborhood disadvantage like high poverty and residential instability. The list of protective factors comes from the Strengthening Families model, developed by the Center for the Study of Social Policy, which is a widely recognized approach to child abuse and neglect prevention that's based on engaging families, programs, and communities. The framework uses five evidence-based protective factors: parental resilience, social connections, concrete support in times of need, knowledge of parenting and child development, and social and emotional competence in children. Policies that use the Strengthening Families framework focus on building these protective factors in early childhood, child welfare, child abuse prevention, and other child and family serving systems. So the factors listed here are intended to be illustrative, not comprehensive. And it's important to recognize three additional things here. First, not all risk and protective factors are created equal. Some are much more influential than others. Second, they've been identified with respect to different populations. For example, some apply more to infants, others to youth. Third, these factors are correlational and not necessarily causal. But before I move on, I want to quickly mention a few other related frameworks. The Essentials for Childhood framework, developed by the CDC's National Center for Injury Prevention and Control, focuses on steps communities can take to create safe, stable, and nurturing relationships in order to prevent child maltreatment. This framework is currently being implemented in 5 states, including California. I want to make sure to mention trauma-informed approaches here, since the topic comes up a lot in discussions of toxic stress. Using one definition from the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, trauma-informed approaches refer to a change in organizational culture that includes 3 elements that are referred to as the 3 R's: realizing the prevalence of trauma, recognizing how trauma affects all individuals involved with the program, organization, or system, and responding by putting this knowledge into practice. These approaches are currently being adopted in a variety of settings around the state. Last and not least, ACEs represents both a conceptual framework and a measurement tool that are both being put to great use in California. I'll leave it to Dr. Hill and Ms. Blake to provide more background on ACEs and share some really exciting ACEs-related work. One reason why we at Children Now are excited to talk about the science of toxic stress is that it cuts across our various areas of research and policy work. Children Now's research work aims to highlight and promote the understanding of childhood issues in the various systems that serve children and families: early child care and education, healthcare, K-12 education, child welfare, juvenile justice, and social services. The research both informs our policy work and provides tools to help others advocate for better policies in the communities that children and caregivers are part of. Whether community is defined geographically, as in a neighborhood, city, or county, virtually, as in a shared identity, ethnicity, or experience, or organizationally, as in a place of work, learning, or living. Children Now's 2014 California County Scorecard will be providing really insightful data on some of the risk and protective factors that I mentioned on the last slide. For example, on the issue of economic hardship, the latest data indicates that across California, 51% of families live below the self-sufficiency standard, meaning they can't afford basic living expenses. 23% of children are living in poverty, and 14% of children are living in communities of concentrated poverty. These data are broken down by county and race or ethnicity and are really well organized and easy to sort. Scorecard's not yet available, but will be at the end of the month, so stay tuned. Now, before turning to our other speakers, I have one more quick poll question. Which system, very loosely defined since we're limited to 5 answers, best describes your primary work area? This might be a bit difficult to answer for some, but it would be great to get a better idea about where everyone's coming from. All right, let's close the poll. And thanks everyone for responding. Just take me a moment again to see the results. All right. All right, interesting. So we have 39% of participants responded early childhood, 14% healthcare, 22% education, 18% child welfare or juvenile justice, and 7% caregiver community or other. So that's an interesting breakdown. I was expecting a little more from healthcare, but not surprising that we have so many early childhood folks, since this is really where the toxic stress concept was developed. All right, our next speakers will be talking about how toxic stress is part of their work in the healthcare system and the public safety and justice system. After their presentations, I'll highlight some of the relevant work Children Now and our partners have been engaged in that intersects multiple systems. I'm very pleased now to introduce Dr. Karen Hill, Vice President of Programs at the Center for Youth Wellness, who will be talking about toxic stress in healthcare. Dr. Hill has a wealth of knowledge and work experience relating to adverse childhood experiences and trauma-informed care, and we really appreciate her joining us today.
Thank you, Ben, and thank you for that informative introduction. The Center for Youth Wellness is 2 years old, and we are located in the Bayview Hunters Point area in San Francisco. This is really, we have a hopeful idea, and our approach is interprofessional and interdisciplinary, and so it's really very exciting for me to see that we have various groups of individuals and professions represented on the webinar today. We have a clinical approach, research, and policy, and our mission is really threefold: prevent, screen, and heal. I am so glad and pleased that we have such an interprofessional and interdisciplinary group in the audience today, and that's really in alignment with the center's approach of looking at the clinical approaches and research and policy. Our mission is threefold. We prevent by increasing awareness with parents and young people, our patients, pediatricians and providers, and policymakers. We screen, and we do this by asking the questions of adverse childhood experiences, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And our goal is ultimately to heal, and we do this by reducing symptoms, potentially healing, and decreasing psychological and physiological morbidity in the long term. We all understand that this is an emerging science, and so one of the things that CYW really prides itself on is identifying emerging and the most promising evidence-based treatments and piloting them at the center and coming up with some of those answers as we discover this work and answers to these problems. One of the things that I want to talk to you about Sasha. It's often nice to bring story and reality to this work. Sasha is an 11-year-old who has had a lot of adversity in her early life. She has lived with her mother and father. Her father is abusive to the mother and to her. Because of that abuse, Sasha's father was actually incarcerated. He had a drinking problem. That resulted in when he went to jail, mom was working and lost her child care and ultimately lost her employment. And if you can see the areas that adverse childhood experiences that we screen for, we look at abuse, we look at neglect, and we look at overall household dysfunction, and we screen. We ask the question. So our 11-year-old Sasha, at her very young age, has a total of 6 ACEs: abuse, domestic violence, parental incarceration and separation from her paternal parent, alcoholism, and then she's got a mother who has depression. Sasha's mother's depression was untreated because she didn't have access to health care. So I just want to put Sasha's problem and her situation on hold for a moment. We had 2 really early innovators, Dr. Vincent Felitti and Dr. Robert Anda, who used a Kaiser population
to start asking these questions about 20 years ago. They asked the questions about experiences, and then they mirrored those, compared those, correlated those, the results with the patient's medical history. And what they found was really startling in this relatively well-resourced community of people who had insurance, and most of them had jobs, and they did have access, that over two-thirds of the adults, or roughly 66%, reported about one-eighth. 12.6% of them reported an ACE score of 4 or greater. And with this information, there was a strong correlation that folks who had an ACE score of 4 or greater had much more chronic illness. There was 2.2 times the amount of ischemic heart disease in the population, 2.4 times is like they were likely to have a stroke. There were increases in cancer and diabetes. This was startling information, and it was groundbreaking. Let's go back to our exemplar, Sasha. Sasha, at the young age of 11, is 2 times more likely to have heart disease, 3 times more likely to have lung disease. She's 3 times more likely to also become pregnant as a teenager. And what is shocking for us all is this takes up 20 years of her life expectancy, 20 years shorter than if she had an ACE score of 0. We can do better. At the Center of Youth Wellness, the early founders were at Bayview Child Care Health Center. That is our part of the pediatric clinic that we partner with. Dr. Nadine Burke and Dr. Victor Carrion, the co-founders, did a retrospective study of participants at the pediatric clinic. And it's interesting that their results mirrored Dr. Folletti's results and Dr. Anda's results. 67% of the population had one ACE score or more, and 12% had an ACE score of 4 or greater. So Ben talked to us earlier about the different types of stress. Can you just imagine that if you were, for someone like Sasha, who has this chronic stress, if you see a bear when you're walking home from school, you would expect that you would want to run. Of course we know that we would want that to happen. We just don't want that to be continuous. And for some of the children and the families that we see in our practice, the bear is always there and the bear never goes away. What happens when this bear is always present? It affects our brain, the prefrontal cortex, our amygdala, and our hippocampus. It increases irritability, we found, poor memory, difficulty focusing, critical thinking is affected, anxiety and fear. This affects all aspects of a young person's life. So let me just talk a bit about our model: prevention, screening, and healing. We have really a very innovative model. It's an integrated practice where we are co-located and embedded within a primary care home. We have a trauma-informed behavioral health program. All of the providers, all of the staff at both sites have been trained about trauma-informed care. We use a universal precautions approach. Everyone who is seen in the primary care clinic is screened for adverse childhood experiences. And then we use a model of nursing services, wellness coordination, and enabling or case management to address those needs. We also build in complementary care services such as biofeedback and mindfulness, in addition to nutrition and exercise programs to address some of these problems. The A screen, the original A screen has 10 questions. We use that A screen, but we also ask 6 new questions that address serious illness or a loss in the family. And we also ask questions about environment and discrimination in foster care or protective services. We do this in a manner where it's nonspecific, so individuals, when they come into the clinic, they don't necessarily have to tell the screener exactly what ACE they had. That's evaluated once we receive referrals from the primary care clinic in the wellness side. And then we dig in a little deeper to find out what the specific problems are so that we can better develop treatment plans. So I'd like to end by saying that we're hopeful about this. How can we, what can we do? What can we all do collectively? I think the first thing we can do is raise awareness about ACEs and toxic stress. We understand that it's a public health crisis and to include diverse stakeholders. Continue to support regular statewide data collection on ACEs and improve access to trauma-informed primary care, nursing services, behavioral health services, enabling services, and complementary care, and to study the outcomes for our community members and our patients. I'd like to close by just saying, if we were to go back to Sasha's story and look at her family, if she had been screened and if she had been identified as somebody with high ACEs, we could have intervened and helped support the family through this difficult time. We might have been able to find housing for mom and treatment for mom and given treatment to Sasha. So I thank you, and I'll turn it back over to Ben.
Terrific. Thank you, Dr. Hill. It's always a pleasure to hear about the exciting work happening at the Center for Youth Wellness and get a more on-the-ground perspective. So next speaker, Milena Blake, will be discussing toxic stress and public health and safety. Ms. Blake has a ton of experience in legislative advocacy, and having worked as a public defender, has a great perspective on the intersection of ACEs and public safety. We're happy to have you here today.
Thank you so much. So again, my name is Milena Blake, and I'm with an organization called Californians for Safety and Justice. We are a statewide criminal justice organization that looks to more effectively and efficiently spend our public safety dollars and reduce waste in the criminal justice system. One of our big priorities for doing that is actually crime prevention. And so we're just thrilled to have partnered with the Center for Youth Wellness and Children's Now on a number of undertakings, including this work on adverse childhood experiences and toxic stress. So I'm here today to talk about how it interacts with sort of an unexpected area, and that's the criminal justice system. You know, I know many people on the call are not familiar with this area, aren't coming from this area, but, you know, having people who have suffered toxic stress or adverse childhood experiences, not only do they have long-term negative health consequences, but they can have serious long-term negative public safety consequences as well. The first place that we see this is actually in school. So as we know, you know, kids who have experienced toxic stress or adverse childhood experiences tend to misbehave in school, and I think that's really common sense to most people on the call. But because of the way that our schools have created this school-to-prison pipeline, bad behavior is often basically criminalized. So you'll have kids who are acting up in class, and they're treated as though, you know, they're little terrorists, and become involved in, they're suspended, they become involved in the juvenile justice system, which ultimately can lead to involvement in the criminal justice system, which is, you know, very clear. People who have experienced involvement in the juvenile justice system are far more likely to be involved in the adult criminal justice system later in life. A 2013 study that screened children who were in the juvenile hall in New Hampshire and Ohio found that over 94% had experienced trauma. Nearly half had suffered from post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, substance abuse, or had multiple mental health issues. And this is consistent with, you know, my anecdotal experience as a public defender. As Ben mentioned, I was a public defender, and I primarily worked with juveniles. And I can tell you most of them came from, you know, really traumatic backgrounds. Most of them came from, you know, a lot of them lived in foster homes or group homes. A lot of them didn't, for those who did live with their parents, it was not a particularly stable environment. So this is just, I think, common sense for a lot of people working in this area. We do know, too, that from research, as we heard, that a man with three or more violent adverse childhood experiences is almost four times as likely to perpetrate domestic violence as an adult. The sort of interesting thing of this is the flip side is also true. Having having adverse childhood experiences or toxic stress means that you're also at increased likelihood of being a victim of crime as well. This idea is called polyvictimization, which is defined as being exposed to multiple types of victimization, and it's related to toxic stress. So what this boils down to, if you are a victim of crime, you're far more likely to be a victim of crime again. And this includes, you know, experiences that you suffer as a child as well. So risk factors that are associated with polyvictimization, distress and chaotic family and living situations, living in a violent neighborhood, having pre-existing psychological trauma are also contributed to toxic stress. And this makes sense. The way this is boiled down often is that hurt people hurt people. The way that this is formulated, or the way that we see this, is that you know, a woman who has three or more violent adverse childhood experiences is almost four times as likely to become a victim of domestic violence or intimate partner violence. So by engaging in early interventions, like we heard from the Center for Youth Wellness, we can not only prevent people from you know, falling into this cycle of you know, the criminal justice system of rolling in and out because of untreated trauma, but we also can prevent people from being victims of crimes as well. You know, which is really what Californians for Safety is all about. It's really all about preventing crime in the first place. So I'm just thrilled to be working with such a great diverse group of people. And I'm happy to answer questions, and I'm going to turn it back over to Ben.
All right. Terrific. Thank you. As Ms. Blake pointed out, the connection between toxic stress and public safety and justice isn't made nearly as often as, say, toxic stress and healthcare. So it's a really critical connection to make, and I'm really thankful that you can share this with everyone. All right. So before discussing some next steps and moving on to questions, I want to quickly highlight some relevant work taking place within California to both highlight how policies along the prevention intervention spectrum can be used to address toxic stress within various systems, and to make connections to some of the work Children Now and our partners have been engaged in. This is, of course, very far from exhaustive, since there's so much great work occurring right now in California aimed at addressing toxic stress, ACEs, and childhood trauma. So while toxic stress is relevant across the lifespan, it's of particular importance in the earliest years, when children's brains are rapidly developing and the foundation for later cognitive and social development is being established. This is a time when families are poorest, parents are the least experienced and most isolated from systems, brain development is most rapid, children are the most dependent emotionally and physically on the adults around them, and the risk of child maltreatment is the greatest. Children and families need access to a comprehensive early childhood system that integrates health, learning, and family supports with a continuum of services that includes early prenatal care, voluntary home visiting, developmental screenings, quality infant and toddler care, and quality preschool and transitional kindergarten. Advocates in California are promoting voluntary home visiting programs to address the needs of children and parents at this stage due to compelling evidence of their effectiveness in preventing child maltreatment, increasing supportive relationships, and promoting child health. Outside of the home setting, advocacy efforts to increase access to high-quality early child care and education programs are aimed at ensuring that care is consistent, developmentally sound, and emotionally supportive of both children and families, all of which are critical for preventing toxic stress. As we heard from Dr. Hill, there's a lot of exciting work afoot to address ACEs in healthcare settings. Developmental and behavioral screenings are a really critical way to identify children's needs as early as possible and connect families with needed services and supports that directly relate to preventing and alleviating risk factors associated with toxic stress. For example, screenings can provide the impetus to get help addressing special needs that might increase caregiver burden, as well as get connected to parenting supports. As discussed by Dr. Hill, a validated ACEs screening tool for children would have enormous value. Advocacy efforts on child-centered health homes, which are envisioned as a more holistic next-generation patient-centered medical home, include efforts to include vulnerable pediatric populations and to focus on trauma-informed care. In our K-12 system, one relevant policy issue is ensuring that students who have experienced toxic stress receive the supports needed to heal and thrive in school. Some students miss a lot of school, and stress, trauma, and unsafe environments are frequently cited as contributing factors. Other students are suspended or expelled from school for willful defiance and disruptive behaviors that in many cases stem from unhealed trauma. In these situations, the provision of services that support healing and social and emotional development can make a huge difference in helping children stay in school. This could potentially be accomplished in many ways, for example, by leveraging the local control funding formula, or LCFF, to bring services and supports to better address toxic stress into schools. Other advocacy efforts have focused on making sure that teacher credentialing processes incorporate trauma-informed knowledges and practices that can help teachers better understand and manage disruptive classroom behaviors. In the child welfare system, there's an imperative to provide priority access to the state's social services, since foster youth are the responsibility of the state. So, for example, some current advocacy efforts focus on ensuring that foster youth are prioritized in developmental and behavioral screenings, health homes, and Medi-Cal, to name just a few in the healthcare realm. Also, by the nature of their entry into the child welfare system, foster children and youth have traumatic histories. To reduce the effects of toxic stress and promote healing, advocacy efforts have focused on ensuring that maltreated children who have been removed from the home are placed in stable homes and can develop supportive lifelong connections. As we heard earlier from Ms. Blake, youth who have histories of trauma are routinely re-traumatized in the juvenile justice system, and there's an increasing recognition of the value of shifting the conversation from punishment and incarceration to providing supports, including for so-called crossover youth who are involved in juvenile justice systems and have histories of neglect and abuse. For example, some efforts in California are explicitly aimed at shifting policies and practices at the county level to ensure the underlying trauma and social and familial disconnection that stand in the way of a successful transition to a healthy adulthood are addressed. Of course, trauma-informed approaches are needed in every system that serves youth and caregivers, and there are a lot of people working around the state to promote that vision. Finally, in the realm of social services, advocacy around maintaining and strengthening the provision of supports and services that help families be financially stable, have housing and food security, deal with domestic violence, and access public health programs are all examples of efforts that can help mitigate some of the known risk factors associated with toxic stress. So what can you do about toxic stress? First, listen to what Dr. Hill said earlier since she addressed this question. Of course, by attending this webinar, you're already educating yourself about toxic stress. On the next slide, I'll provide some pointers to resources that inform the webinar and provide great ways to continue learning about toxic stress. Start a conversation in your community or communities, however you define them. Find out what people are already doing or identify some gaps and start talking about what's needed. Youth Children Now's forthcoming California County Scorecard to identify what needs are greatest where you live and work. Explore some of the conceptual and policy frameworks about toxic stress and its causes and effects, like ACEs, childhood trauma, and child maltreatment, and consider how they may apply to your work. Definitely thank your representative in Sacramento for supporting ACR 155, especially if your representative happens to be Assemblymember Bocanegra, who authored the resolution, or one of the 67 assembly members who signed on as co-authors. There are discussions taking place now about how best to follow up on the resolution, and these efforts will ultimately benefit from legislators knowing that this issue is important to you, as well as how it affects your family, work, and community. And finally, stay tuned for more information and advocacy opportunities through the Children's Movement. On this final slide, I've listed some of the key resources discussed during the webinar, which will be hyperlinked in the version distributed by email. On the science of toxic stress and childhood adversity, the Center on the Developing Child, which developed the concept and made it accessible to so many communities, has a website that's really a treasure trove of resources. I've listed a few particularly useful ones here. There's an issue brief on toxic stress, an online professional development on the science of development, and the spectrum of neglect, which is about four types of unresponsive care and their consequences. For more information on communication strategies and how to talk about toxic stress, there's some great resources available online from the Framework Institute. I've included some links to the conceptual and policy frameworks discussed earlier, plus a couple of other notable ones from the ACYF, which describes the strength of the evidence base for various protective factors, and from the American Academy of Pediatrics, which lays out a multidisciplinary framework for understanding how human health and disease evolve across the lifespan. To follow all the latest and greatest ACEs work, I've also referenced ACEs Too High, a terrific news site that reports on ACEs research and how people are implementing practices based on the research. The remaining links point to ACR 155, the three organizations you've heard from this morning, and how to reach us for any follow-up questions, comments, or discussions. So let's leave this slide up and use the remaining time for questions and answers. First question, any ideas to support little children with the stress of divorced parents who do not get along? The child I'm thinking of has two parents and two nannies and comes to preschool. And Dr. Hilleland.
Part of our principles in our program at CYW is that we address children within the context of family. So we provide family therapy. One of the approaches might be that you talk to parent and one parent and child at a time and talk to the father, talk to the mother, and then see if they would agree to having family therapy. So family therapy is a good way to approach this problem. And you, both parents, we know, love the child, and that's really the context that you approach this, that you're going to try to make a better environment for the child by them getting along with each other.
All right, next one. I know families living in Bayshore in San Francisco that see a lot of violence and even children getting shot and killed. I suggested they go and see the clinic of Dr. Nadine Burkaris. They say, we are strong Tongans. We don't need help. However, I see one of their children getting more violent and anxious. Is there a respectful way to encourage this family to allow their children to talk with experts on the stress in their neighborhood?
I think that one of the things, this is an interesting question because culture, ethnicity, and ideas around stigma associating with being weak. I would start with a family. This family would be, is just to talk to them about what we've found in the literature, that this doesn't have anything to do with race, ethnicity. It really has to do with being human. And so by talking to them in a way that is, that they don't have to be defensive, maybe provide some literature for them, and possibly even go on to some of our, the CYW website and just sit down with a parent and just show them some of the information that we have found. We do have patients in the clinic of all ethnicities. So this is not, and it doesn't have anything to do with being strong or weak. It just has to do with living in a very violent community and how we respond.
All right, got another for Dr. Hill. Can bullying lead to toxic stress?
I think that bullying absolutely can lead to toxic stress because it's relentless and unremitting. If children are going to school every day and they're being bullied by their schoolmates, we've seen in the news as of late that young people are killing themselves as a result of bullying. But what I will also say that the perpetrators of bullying are, it's a symptom. It's a symptom of high ACEs, and that's why it's really a call to action.
All right, next one. I don't really understand the clear distinction between child maltreatment, childhood trauma, and ACEs. Can you clarify how they're all distinct from one another? Seems like maltreatment and trauma may fit under ACEs.
Thank you. That's actually a good question. I'm going to try to answer it. From my perspective, I consider child maltreatment the big overall heading, and ACEs fall underneath that heading. Do you want to add anything to that, Ben?
Yeah, I think that's a great way to think about it. I guess, yeah, the picture in my head I have is sort of like a big Venn diagram where child maltreatment, childhood trauma, and ACEs are highly overlapping. And I'd actually, you know, these are terms that are used colloquially but also have been operationalized by different folks and organizations. So I think, you know, there might be some things that are considered, you know, as falling under one or two of these headings and not others. And off the top of my head, I can't tell you what those might be. But they are all very closely related. And all of them, you know, include a lot of circumstances that often cause toxic stress. I know we have a couple here for Ms. Blake. Do you think that change in education around suspensions will over time show it to be mitigated?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think this question is about the school-to-prison pipeline and how that will impact the effect of toxic stress onto putting more kids into the juvenile justice and later criminal justice system. And I think that's absolutely correct. I think this is related to some of the things that we're talking about today. If schools and teachers and other officials start treating behavior that's a result of toxic stress as a medical issue rather than as a behavioral issue or worse as a criminal issue, we'll absolutely see a decline in the way that interacts with. And there is a significant amount of work that's going on to reduce that, or actually to eliminate that school-to-prison pipeline. There have been a number of bills, and I was trying to double check, and I don't know off the top of my head, but there was a bill this year that would remove willful defiance as a reason for expulsion and suspension in elementary schools, which basically means when the kid's acting bad, you can suspend them, which is a terrible signal to send a child that the way we punish you is by removing you from educational system. So there is definitely a change in that, and I think we will actually see a reduction in that school-to-prison pipeline and therefore on the impacts of toxic stress into putting people into the criminal justice system.
To that end, one of CYW's approaches is to educate educators. We're in the process of developing a training program for San Francisco Police Department so that people understand what really is operating when a child acts out or gets in trouble in school, that it's really not the child's fault, and the answer is really not to remove them, as Ms. Blake just said to us, excuse me. So I really feel like the education is really, really what we need to be focusing on, is just getting the word out.
Here's another one for Ms. Blake. Is there a resource that shows the amount of juvenile crime that occurs per zip code?
Unfortunately, there isn't, but there is a really great report that was just released by the Attorney General of California, Kamala Harris, on juvenile justice in California. It's called Juvenile Justice in California, and I'm happy to send that link out. It doesn't break it down by zip code, but it does give a number of great data points that you can use, and I would encourage you, actually, to tell the Attorney General that we would love to have that kind of data. Even by county would be helpful, but unfortunately, it's just not collected and reported in that way, which would make it far more useful for lots of people on the call and people advocating across the state.
What were the three R's for factors? So this was this refers to the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration's three R's under their definition of trauma-informed approaches. So that would be realizing the prevalence of trauma, recognizing how trauma affects all individuals involved with the program, organization, or system, and responding by putting this knowledge into practice. And I should add that they like their definitions to come in easy chunks like this. So their definition of trauma, they call the three E's. So trauma is the sum of the event, the individual's experience of the event, and the long-term adverse effects on an individual. Please repeat the name of the community scorecard you mentioned on our next steps. That would be the Children Now's 2014 California County Scorecard, which is not available yet, but will be by the end of the month. How do we reverse toxic stress in unborn children and their mothers?
This is a good question, and this is what I would propose. I'm not sure that we can reverse toxic stress, but what we can do is we can screen parents, screen mothers, we can offer them resources and give them ways to help at least reduce their stress and become aware of it. Moms don't often understand the link between, or may not understand the link between their emotions and how they feel and how it is addressing or it's affecting their unborn child. So my first response would be to ask the question, and the second response would be to link moms to supportive services.
This concludes our webinar on how toxic stress impacts California's children, families, and communities. Thank you for your attendance.